What's happening? What's happening? What's happening? Of course, you know it's your boy Beehive Radio shout in. As always, I got my podcast partner off in this thing, OG Gangsta Wicked of Ghetto Mafia. Or should I say, Galaxy Mafia?
Galaxy Wick, man. Everybody already calling me Galaxy anyway, Beehive. So you can sit there and kiki and cook. You don't got your hair done. And you can sit here, you know, try to play games with my name.
I ain't playing games.
But the people have spoken. The people like Galaxy. I see more galaxies out there than Beehive. How about that?
Oh, Lord.
Since you're taking shots at me.
See,
how about that?
Okay, then, intergalactical player. Answer me this, man. We got a special guest in the building today.
Absolutely.
Can you let the world know who we have in this thing, sir?
As a matter of fact, this is a childhood friend of mine.
Okay.
Remember when we had, if y'all hadn't seen it, we had a coach in a few weeks ago.
That's right, Coach Chisholm.
Ex-Marine.
Yeah.
And he was talking about the whole football story and stuff. And I remember I had told y'all, I said, that these are the type of stories I like. When we do the rap and, when me and you going back and forth, you know, joking with each other, I love that.
That's right.
But these are the stories that, you know, that resonate with me, with my family, you know what I'm saying? So today we got a friend of mine, which is Brandy Brown, which is the daughter of ex-sheriff-elect Doran Brown.
Yes, sir.
If y'all don't know out there, I'll give y'all a minute to, you know, Google the whole story. You know, her father had warned the sheriff of DeKalb County.
Correct.
And was assassinated.
Yes, sir.
And so, you know, I talked her into coming in today to, you know what I'm saying, to talk about, PTSD.
Correct.
For people that have lost loved ones, whether it's a child, whether it's a mother, whether it's a daughter, whether it's uncle, aunt, anything like that. So these are the type of stories that I think are very important for the show that sets us apart from a lot of the other podcasts. So Brandy Brown is here today. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
See, Brandy's impressed because she's thinking, I never thought that this gangbanger that I grew up with would be one of the greatest journalists ever born.
I was not a gangbanger. You're putting out, that's a false narrative that you're putting out on me. You're trying to assassinate my character.
I'm sorry, Wick. Brandy, can you share your story with us, though? And
absolutely.
Talk about the PTSD part, too, as well, because that's one of the things that concerns me a lot, because just survivor's remorse that people deal with as well as just the post-traumatic stress of it all. Can you speak to all of that for
absolutely,
us?
Absolutely. So, my father was assassinated in 2000, and actually December 15th, 2000, which was my mother's birthday.
Wow.
So, that particular day we were celebrating, he graduated from Sheriff's Academy, and we were also celebrating my mom's birthday when he was killed. So, what intrigued me about coming on was when we were talking about PTSD trauma, right? What a lot of people don't realize is the general public has more PTSD than veterans.
Oh, wow. My God.
Wow.
If you look at, studies have shown, they did over 9 continents where they did this study. And a lot of people, we brush off a lot of the things that we go through in day-to-day life, but these things are traumatic.
That's right.
Right? And let's just say, for instance, some things that may not be traumatic to me could be traumatic to you.
Thanks.
How it affects you in your brain is totally different than it may affect me.
Yeah.
And so because of that, a lot of times we're forced, we like brush stuff off, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not a big deal. And then you, as that person who's gone through it, you start taking on, everybody else is like, it's not that serious. So it's like, oh, it must not be that serious.
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, you walking around here totally traumatized. You walking around with PTSD.
Right.
Nobody is forcing you to get help, right? Mm-hmm. And in our community especially, that's a stigma.
Right.
You say you're going to therapy.
Right.
Everybody looking at you crazy.
Come
you
on.
Know what I mean? And so you just think back how when you were younger, you know, I'm pretty sure growing up, you had friends that were killed, family members, all types of things. But how many times did somebody stop and say, you know what? You need help processing that. You need therapy.
Right. Yeah. Right.
We don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know? So after my father was assassinated, that number one, it completely just took my mom out.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Like, she was barely functional after that.
Now, and before you go any further, I want to talk about that. One, I want to know, what was your father like, you know, before, you know, he passed? What kind of man was he? What are some of the things that he liked? And then my second question after you tackle that, what was your mother like before the incident versus after the incident? Well, did you see the change in her? Did that change affect you and your kids? But the first thing is, you know, tell us a little bit about your father, ex-Sheriff Durham Brown. What kind of guy was he? And what kind of father was he to you?
Oh, he was charismatic. He was the type of person, he lit up a room wherever he walked in. He commanded attention naturally. Yeah. You know what I mean? I always laugh because I say a lot of people, my father was from New York.
Okay.
You know, New Yorkers, they speak the truth.
That's absolutely right.
But my father was very intelligent.
Yes.
A well-studied man. Mm-hmm. And so he was the type of person, you could sit and have a whole conversation, and then by the time he walk off, he'd be like, wait a minute, did he just tell me off?
Right.
But you was intrigued. You was in the conversation. You was in it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And he'd be like, wait a minute, this someone just called me off. Right. You know what I'm, because he had a way with words.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Now, my mama, she from Fourth Ward.
Okay.
She straight up cut your ass out.
Okay, now.
Please believe it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so, but he was loving, community oriented. Mm-hmm. My father was a father to many people in our neighborhood.
Yeah.
You know, I can remember there was a neighbor that was a missionary. Mm-hmm. She was always bringing kids from the church over and or calling him and saying, I need you to come talk to these boys. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just who he was. That's who my mom was. Mm-hmm. Don't get it twisted.
Right.
They were definitely kindred spirits.
Right.
They shared the same philosophy. Children are the future.
Wow.
So my mother was a mother to many kids as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our house was the house.
Yeah.
All the kids was there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my parents were very active. So kids that played football, they may have single parents. They couldn't get back and forth to practice. They was picking them up. They was taking them.
Yeah.
You know, my dad worked a lot. So in between jobs, you know, because police officers work multiple jobs.
That's right.
You know, so in between, he's here, he's there. You know, and at one point, he became the commissioner of the football park that we played at. Mm. But just very hands-on.
Yeah.
It was funny because she was also like an introvert, right?
Right.
So she's the type of person, she would like to stay home, read books. Mm-hmm. My dad, we were out. We going to Midway Pool, going swimming. Mm-hmm. We going to the movies. Mm-hmm. You know, mom like, I stay home. I'm going to stay and I'm going to read. I'm going to relax, you know. But he was everything. He was everything to everybody.
Wow. Wow.
And even my mom.
Yeah.
You know. And it's funny because I run into people and they talk about how much their life changed after losing them.
Right.
So directly you think it just affects us.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? But
were you kind of shocked, Brandy, about when he passed and she passed? Were you, I know you knew how much people cared about them, but were you kind of surprised at how many people cared about him? And, you know, because I my grandfather passed, you know, I knew that he had touched a lot of lives, but I didn't realize it until, you know, the outpouring of everything, like, man, there's people coming from Cali,
yeah.
People coming from overseas. I didn't know, back in the day, he used to be over in China, you know, and I'm like, and these people, you know, your grandfather was this. Were you shocked that just how far his reach went?
So yes and no, right? Mm. Because I spend a lot of time with my dad, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we literally could go, you remember Cub Foods on Covenant Highway?
Yeah.
We going grocery shopping, right?
Yeah.
We got a buggy full of groceries.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody damn stop them. We standing in the store. It's our. I'm like, daddy. The ice cream melting. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
No matter where we went, they were always gravitated to them.
Mm-hmm.
They knew who they were. We were always being stopped. They always talking to them, asking them questions.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like, yes, mm-hmm. on one hand, because to this day, I still get stopped when people know who I am, when they recognize me,
right.
You know, and I still learn new stories today.
Crazy.
About my parents.
Wow.
And the things that they've done and their impact on people.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, yes. But then also no, because I felt it even then. I knew how strong my parents' presence was.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
I knew it even at a young age. I knew their impact on people.
Right.
You know, now to see people really show their appreciation for it, that's a different story, right?
Yeah. Right.
So, so yes and no.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. Now to the second part of that, you know, after your mother passed in 2006, am I correct? If I'm wrong,
Christmas Eve
on 2006, right? After your father was assassinated, do you think that was a direct link to her health failing, or do you think that, you know, if he was still alive, it would have, you know, she would have succumbed to that anyway? Or do you think that was a direct link to?
Absolutely. My father's death was a direct link to a lot of stuff.
Right.
I mean, he was the rock of our entire family.
Right.
So we literally fell apart.
Mm. Wow.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And we were young. I just turned 22.
Mm.
Yes, I was married. I had a house. I had kids, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was very much, especially me. Now, my brothers, you know, boys need their father.
Right.
But I was a daddy's girl.
Exactly.
That was my daddy.
Right. Yeah. Right.
That was my daddy. Right. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I will never forget, a good friend of ours, and I was employed at, you know, her company, and she was good friends with my parents. And so one day while he was running for sheriff, we were talking, and she asked me, she said, "Do you think your dad's going to win this election?" You know, and I said, "He think he gonna win, so yeah."
Right.
You know, my father was my go-to.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, it was no question. Other people would pray for guidance. I just went to my daddy.
Yeah,
right. It was that simple for me.
Right.
I'm gonna go to him. Yeah. We gonna talk about it. And whatever that final decision was, it was what it was.
Right.
I was married, but when I went house hunting, I took my daddy.
Right. Come on now. Right.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. That's what he was. He was my world.
Mm. Right.
You know? So everything changed. I was lost.
Mm. Did you find yourself, after he passed, having to, you know, like step up and beat a rock?
I became the mother. My mother could not mother.
Mm.
My mother was so broken. She couldn't help us navigate. And we were still kids. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But she couldn't even process what was going on. I became the mother.
Wow.
I became the person to, you know, guide my brothers and my mother. And, you know, when she got to a point where she couldn't even do interviews, I was the one having to speak to the media and meet with these politicians and attorneys. I became that person at 22.
Right. And you know, I want to pivot to something else. you know, for all y'all out there that has checked, you know the story or are learning the story right now, there was a part in it that really, you know, my heart fell and I felt bad, bad, bad for you guys. It's when I found out how much resistance the county gave y'all. You know, you would think something like that, me and B.I. discussed it, that it's cut and dry.
Yeah.
You know, you had someone that worked for this county that was corrupt, mm-hmm. that your father was going to clean up. Mm-hmm. And y'all assassinated him. And then you're trying to come with a loophole that he wasn't quite hired at the time. Or, mm-hmm. you know. Was that like a slap in the? How did you deal with that? Like, if the same thing happened to me, Brandy, your grace is just like, I have to applaud that because I couldn't have done it. I would have probably killed somebody. I would have or threatened. So I would have been behind bars behind that part of it. Mm-hmm. I look at the county as letting y'all down. First of all, they should have took this stuff a lot more serious. I see now with things like Victor Hill.
Mm-hmm.
He just got 18 months for, you know, for some of the same behavior that the other guy was doing. Mm-hmm. And I see they took Clayton County, they took it serious. I feel like DeKalb County let y'all down and then slapped y'all in the face by not just giving you a blank check. What somebody on their staff has done this to y'all. Mm-hmm. How did that make you feel, Brandy?
Well, so I was very angry, right? Pissed. It showed me politics.
Right. Yeah.
It's so much more behind the scenes. And so I knew there was a lot behind the scene because I sat on many conversations that my father had when we talked about, when he was talking about politics. So I was that person sitting at the table when he's sitting at the table with, you know, his buddies, his comrades. So I knew what was going on, but I never thought, I guess I didn't realize how high up it went, number one. And I never thought that they would just blatantly be disrespectful.
Right.
Get what I'm saying?
Right.
But a lot of people in the county didn't like my father because he had no fear and he could not be bought.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
If you go back and look, my father was writing in the Champion newspaper for years, calling out all the Cab County shit. The pastors, the, you know, the politicians, calling them out. Right? So they knew once he got in office, all that shit's gonna come out.
Right.
What y'all been looking at over these decades, that's the surface. Y'all have no clue. Right. And if you think about it, let's just be logical, right? If something like that happens, easily the county is going to write a check.
Right.
Because they're liable.
Well, correct.
Right?
Correct.
Easily.
Right.
So for the county to sit and say, we're not responsible, and then it goes to the state, well, the state responsible, the state say, I'm not responsible. They going back and forth. And this is their
sheriff. Right.
What I mean, realistically, just as a person, what does that tell you?
I couldn't understand it. Maybe you can help me with that. Understand that even if her father was not at the particular time sworn in yet, right?
Yeah.
He still got assassinated by somebody that one of your employers, meaning if I work for Beehive, and I go out and do something heinous to someone else.
Yeah.
On your watch.
On my watch. Represent me.
Represent you. You're liable for that. So they're gonna people are gonna say, well, you shouldn't have hired him, or you should have screened him better, or you should have understood. So help me understand, why wouldn't they cut a check? Because you're smarter than me.
I don't understand it. It doesn't make any sense to me.
Right.
Well, if we all on this side of the table and you over there and we over here and we don't like you and we all got our reasons and we know why and we take you out, we ain't trying to help your family.
Right.
So that's what I'm telling you. If they all on the same team, why would we think that they are going to show grace and show sympathy and say we got to do right by them?
So for me hearing that, it sounds like what you're saying is that it was bigger than just the four that did it. So let me ask you another question. Do you think that more people should have been arrested? Do you think more people, absolutely, you know, has blood on their hands that got away with it?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And those people know that I know. Trust me, when they see me, they avoid me. They turn the other way because they know that I know. It was way bigger. I mean, even if you sat in on a trial, okay? Dorsey was having officers take his kids McDonald's to school. He was having officers drive his family to New York, move his daughter from college or whatever, right? He had inmates working on properties that they own that were in Atlanta, right? Renovating properties and stuff like that. He also had sheriff's deputies working for his private security company, but they were still on county time, right?
Right, so they get paid both ways. He's getting the check and gave them the contract.
Correct.
So he's getting paid on both sides.
Right. Mm-hmm. So that, granted, I get all of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when he lost sheriff's role, right? You still have your security firm, okay? Realistically, you could still do what you want to do to make a living, and you get what I'm saying?
Right.
And he had a lot of power. Don't get me wrong. If you know, Dorsey's family is from the city of Atlanta. His father was a pastor.
I didn't know that.
He was a clergyman. He had a lot of power with the churches. Wow. So that's what people don't realize. My father, one, what he did was impossible. Right. He didn't have the backing of the politicians. He didn't have the backing of the church.
Right.
What he did, he pulled off. They couldn't even fathom that would have happened.
Right.
He pulled off the impossible.
Right.
Right? Because he didn't have all of that in his back pocket. Dorsey did. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So even if after he left office, he still could have been okay.
Yeah. Right.
So what would be so drastic that you would risk your life to take somebody else's life for a position.
Right.
You right. get what I'm saying?
Yeah. Absolutely.
You're talking about millions of dollars. We ain't talking about no little money. We ain't talking right. about no damn McDonald's.
Right. Yeah. Right.
You get what I'm saying?
Right.
When you talk about stuff like that, you're talking about millions and millions of dollars.
Right.
And at that time, I think the sheriff's department had a $50 million budget. And all of that is contracts.
Correct.
People don't pay attention
to
that.
And he's over that. The sheriff, a lot of people, if y'all don't know that, the sheriff can allocate those contracts out, that money out. So basically, what he was doing was racketeering because he was taking that county money. And then services his own, you know, security company, as she said, this and that.
Who's behind the contracts? That's the bigger money.
Right.
Who had the medical contract? Who had the food contract? See, when my father took office, not only did he say that a lot of those people was going to be, remember he gave out letters to everybody that would be let go.
Yeah.
But he also said, I'm pushing out all these contracts and everybody will be reviewed. And I will decide on the contracts that would be let back into the sheriff's department. Nobody ever talked about that.
Now, Brandy, when back then, I know you were young and you living your life, so you know you got 5 foot in to the politics just because it's your father, but 5 foot in just to being a 22-year-old. Mm-hmm. At that time, as you look back now, mm-hmm. when he issued those letters and stuff out to different people, letting them know that hey, your time is finna be cut short. Mm-hmm. Did you even get a second thought? That could be dangerous.
So it was a lot going on during the campaign. We already knew it was dangerous.
Okay.
And the thing is, my family has the gift of sight.
Right.
My grandmother, if she told you something was going to happen, you best believe it was going to happen. And so during that time, my aunt and my grandmother had visions. And then I started having visions. So we knew something went right. And we all went to my father at different times. And the one thing that he said was, I'm not afraid to die for what I believe in.
Wow.
That's number one.
Wow.
But number two, what he told me was that he, in his mind, I guess, I don't know whether it was the police department. I don't know where he thought he had his support. Okay. Mm-hmm. But what he told me, and I will never forget it, because I told him, one day I was riding with him and I had a vision. And I had been having them while I was driving, but this time I actually was with him. And I turned away and I was looking out the window and I was crying and I couldn't stop it. And I was in my mind, I was like, I got to say something. Mm-hmm. And so I turned to him and I said, Daddy, I said, if something happens to you, I'm going to die. Mm. And he said, nothing's going to happen to me. And I was like, it's too much going on. And he said, Dorsey don't want to start a war in DeKalb County. That's what he said. Wow. And that gave me a little confidence. Like, he right. Mm-hmm. My daddy done did too much for too many people.
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying? He's led too many people in his police department for them to let some shit like that happen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So when everything went down, in my mind, you get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm, you know how Black Cats was back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck around and find out.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
What's your thought? That's what I wanted to clear up, because I was unclear. That was he just a police officer, or was he in the Black Cats task force?
My father used to be over Black Cats.
He was over the Black Cats.
My father went through many ranks in the police department.
Okay.
So at one time he was over the Black Cats.
Gotcha.
But during the time when he transferred one sheriff's department, he was a captain at South Precinct.
Gotcha.
At that time.
Okay.
But I don't know. I just feel like if this had happened in New York, shit would have went real different.
Right.
Because them New York police officers don't play about their people.
Absolutely.
So you got this whole, and so it's the inner battle for me, right? Because when you look at all the things that happened during the time when police was, killing our men and stuff like that, and you got this code of blue, right? So in my mind, where the fuck was the code of blue when y'all let this nigga take my daddy out?
Right, yeah.
Where was y'all code of blue? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, right.
What happened to it? What did it do? So when you say you know, if it was you, you've been ready to kill somebody. Trust me, we done had many days that because it's a blessing and a curse. I tell people that's why I'm so versatile. I can go from Glenwood to the mayor's ball, switch it up, and you ain't gonna never know the difference. That's I'm gonna fit in either way.
Right.
So I still have that in me. My mind and my brother and them still have it. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
But then at the same time, I honor my parents.
Right.
So that's what walks me back in my thought process. You get what I'm saying? That's what makes me say, wait a minute. You can't be on the news because you done did some crazy shit.
Right.
Because now everything that they built and what they stood for, you're tearing down.
Wow.
So that is the part that keeps that balance. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
Because trust me, I.
Before all this happened, Did you know Sidney Dorsey? Was he like a fake friend? You know how you had these fake friends and then they cross you? Was he somebody that you, so your dad and him never?
So here's the thing. What a lot of people don't know, because everything that happened in 2000, my father actually ran for sheriff in 96 for the first time.
Okay.
So when he ran in 96, he ran against Dorsey.
Okay.
And he lost.
Okay.
Dorsey won. And so at that time, right, it set a precedence because this Dorsey was the first African-American sheriff of DeKalb County.
Gotcha.
Now, mind you, there had been previous sheriffs that had been locked up for corruption.
Right.
Well, guess who led the investigation? My daddy.
Damn.
Wow.
So the thing is, the things that he wanted to do in the county is not, you have a lot of politicians that go into politics, they just wake up, they're like, I want to do this, I want to do that. My daddy been doing it. He been doing it, and he wanted to get in, right? Because he realized that the corruption was so deep that he had to get in to get that power to make that change, to really gut it.
Right, right.
You see what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So that is why he ran for sheriff. He actually was at the sheriff's department before he was a police officer way back in the day, back in the 70s. People don't know that.
Right.
And then he left and went to the police department and always vowed that he would come back and straighten out the sheriff's department.
He did that.
Yeah. Also in DeKalb County. My father, back in the, I think it was the 70s or the 80s, him and a few other officers, they sued DeKalb County. A lot of people don't know that. There were no African American people or officers being promoted.
Okay.
They were overlooking them.
Mm-hmm.
DeKalb County was predominantly white. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So they sued the county. For basically, I guess you can say affirmative action, essentially, right?
Mm-hmm.
But so that they can start promoting African Americans.
Right.
So that's what I'm saying. What he was doing in 2000, that shit is not new. He's been doing it. That's who he was. That's to his core.
Right.
That's who he was. He's going to make shit right wherever he go. He ain't standing for anything.
Right.
You can't tell him anything and just think he gonna take it. No, you're going to make it right.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's who he was.
Be how get in here.
This question is about your mama. With your daddy being as ambitious as he was, all of the goals and the hopes and the dreams and the things that he achieved, I know for a fact that he would not have been able to do it without your mama. Therefore, she went through all of that stuff with him.
Mm-hmm.
And for him to have that miracle of a win and then everything to be taken down in the assassination, what was her reaction to it? And was she ever able to recover from that?
Mm-mm. So, like I said, it was a rough election, right? Just the whole campaign process.
Yeah.
People don't realize my father was being followed. Like, they was following him. Like, it was a lot of shit that went on during this election. So that's what I'm saying. It wasn't like peaches and cream and then all of a sudden this happened.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So it was a lot of stuff that was going on. So she was already stressed out. You know what I'm saying? And she was just ready for it to be over.
Yeah.
She was ready for it to be over. And so when he won, it was like, oh, my God, we felt like we could finally breathe, you know.
Right.
Once he finished the Sheriff's Academy, they were getting ready to go take a vacation. You know what I'm saying? So once he was assassinated, I mean, I don't even know how to say it. It just took her out. It literally took her out. Like, she didn't have no fight. And then on top of that, you telling us, we can't even get his benefits. And he'd been a police officer for 24 years? Y'all don't even want to give us his life insurance. Like, y'all making us fight for this shit? You see what I'm saying? Right. So she had to go back and fight. Like, people don't realize we was fucked up.
Yeah. Right.
We was messed up. Like, financially, thank God we believe in life insurance outside of your job.
Yeah. Right.
If y'all ain't got it, get it.
Right.
Because you don't never know what's going to happen.
Exactly.
Because you're talking about literally a weekend. By that Monday, he would have been sworn in and he would have had the benefits of being the sheriff.
Right.
So you literally talking about within a weekend. You know what I mean?
Right.
So make sure you got life insurance. You have life insurance. But essentially, she had to fight. So it's like, it's crazy. Like you said, these are people that you've been working with, supposedly, right? Because we're all in this together. We're all supposed to be fighting for the community and helping the people
mm-hmm.
together.
Mm-hmm.
So why are we having to fight you all just for the benefits? It should have just been done off GP. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So we did have some people that kind of stuck by us during that time that helped with that fight. Mm-hmm. But just the fact that there was one, it's crazy. Broke her. And no, she never recovered.
What was that like seeing your mama never recovering from it? And what was the difference between her before and after that you can really just say, this ain't my mama no more?
Mm-hmm. It was a lot. You know, it was just, I don't know if just think, imagine just constant mourning, depression, and then that transfers to anger and, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Drinking. And it was rough. It was really, really rough. And it was hard because we were so young.
Mm-hmm.
So we literally had nobody to turn to. You know, so it's like, how do you process this? And the one person, even though, yes, she's going through it, the one person as a child that you look to help you process it, she's going through it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she was going through it. It literally broke her heart. And she never recovered. And then after that, she had a stroke. And so then at that point, I really became mom, right? She had a stroke, and then her mother came down with dementia. My mother was the only child. So I end up moving both of them in with me, and I was the caretaker, you know. So I'm handling family business. I'm physically taking care of her, and, you know, and I took care of her and my grandmother to both of their deaths. They literally both died in my hands.
You know what?
Mm-hmm.
That's just too damn stressful.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Taking care with dealing with people after they've had strokes, I've done that myself, and that is a difficult task. Seeing people with dementia, I've seen that firsthand, and I know that that's also a difficult task. But to move them both into the house with you while you trying to live your life, because you still are alive.
They were my life. At that point, that was my life. I had no life. My life was being a mom, trying to make sure.
But how can you be a mom when you got to be a daughter and a granddaughter? To the
it
max.
It all played hand in hand. You get up in the morning, you got to fix everybody breakfast, you got to feed, you got to, you know, at one point I had to, you know, change my mama, you know what I'm saying, while we went through rehab.
Yeah.
I mean, it all just, that was my life for many years. My mother passed, you know, Christmas Eve while we were getting ready. I had a family tradition. We would all come over to my house, do cookies and, mm-hmm. you know, marshmallows, hot chocolate for Christmas Eve. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and we were getting ready for that. And I don't know if she had another stroke. I don't know if she had a heart attack, but ended up having to do CPR and call a 911 on, you know, Christmas Eve, you know,
wow.
having to stop everything. And that was 2006. And then my grandmother in 2012, I was literally changing her. We were talking. Like, I was changing her, cleaning her up, and we were talking while I was cleaning her up. And then all of a sudden, she wasn't talking. And I'm like, Grandma, you know, Grandma. So then when I flipped her back over, I realized that she was, like, out of it. So I immediately had to start CPR on her, you know. But I ended up, of course, losing both of them.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Let me flip to... change some lighter. You got a podcast. that's coming out with this podcast. One, what's the name of the podcast? And two, you know, what do you want this podcast, how do you want this podcast to be received by people? You know, what is it about? Can you give me a little synopsis about it?
Absolutely. So the first series that we're working on currently is The Naked Truth is the name of the podcast.
The Wicked Truth. The Naked Lord. Truth. You see what I'm saying?
Wicked just want to get
we think alike. That's that Decatur. That's that Decatur.
But it's definitely, it's naked, right? So it's stripping it all down. Okay. It's The Naked Truth. So first, The Naked Truth, let me tell you where the name came from. Mm-hmm. So, like I said, my father, back in the day, my father had a TV show on local cable channel. You remember back in the day, he had a local little channel you had. Mm-hmm. So, and his TV show was called The Naked Truth.
Gotcha.
And so he would interview people, and it would be, you know, and I think mostly probably back then it was a lot of politics and community stuff, mm-hmm. right? But just like, what's the naked truth? What's going on? Just, mm-hmm. you know, and so as I was tossing in my head, you know, what am I going to name this podcast? Because ultimately the idea came about, we weren't even sure if it was going to be a podcast. Mm-hmm. The idea came about because one thing I realized, it'll be 23 years, December 15th this year. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of generations are out of touch with that information,
right?
They were really young, half paid attention to what was going on, right? Mm-hmm. And so they don't know who he was. Mm-hmm. They don't know what really happened. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there's a Masonic Lodge named after my father,
okay.
The Derwin Brown Masonic Lodge. And so there are young guys coming into that lodge, right? And so even South Precinct is named after my father. You got young police officers. Wow. And so you have all these people that are coming through and they don't have no clue who he is. Like, right. How can you sit in a building or be a part of something with his name on it and not understand why his name is on it?
Right.
And
right. So
that is where the idea came from. We were like, you know what? We're going to put something together to, you know, talk about who he was, what he accomplished, but also who was he as a person? I've done many TV shows, Oxygen, BET, you know, the ID channel. Mm-hmm. And it all talks about what happened. But people don't understand the true impact. It's like, yeah, they sympathize. I get, when the shows come out, my box is like blown up, right? Because mm-hmm. everybody is sympathizing. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, the impact of that loss was so much bigger than just us.
Yeah. Right.
The Cap Canada went to shit.
I said
since
that.
2000.
Remember, I told you that, B-Hop.
You know, it has gone to shit. And I've talked to many officers, and you know what all of them say? Right. The consensus is, he said, there's no leadership. He said, since your father has been gone, there has not been any true leader.
But then I'm going to have to say this, the tragic way in which your father was assassinated, who would fill those shoes?
Everybody,
if you know that that's what's going to happen, if you come in there and try to change stuff, nobody's going to be in a rush to do that.
Well, and so I had this conversation the other day with, I get it. I understand, right? But at the same time, where is our world going to if we don't have any true leaders? If everybody...
My question is, Brandy, what role do you want to play in the Cobb County government? Because you got the pedigree for that.
I get that a lot. So you know what? And interesting enough, I was having breakfast the other day and I ran across some people in the government. They were there, right? Mm-hmm. And so here's the thing. The corruption is so deep and intertwined. You are very limited unless you really ready to call people out on their shit, dig deep. Like, you know what I mean? Like, my father had investigators. Like, he found out information nobody would have found out. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? To really make a difference. I personally, you know, feel like you can make a difference with the people because I'm for the people. Mm-hmm. Fuck politics. Mm. Everybody in politics for they self. It's a power struggle. It's ego. It's like, oh, I'm this person. I it's very hard to find a genuine politician. Man, I like being on the nonprofit side.
Yeah.
Because I can truly help people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Our kids are lost. You see what I'm saying? It's not many people out there like my parents anymore where their house is the house where I'm going to take, I can take such and such to practice. I can pick them up. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Where they can come in and have a conversation just about life. Mm-hmm. It's not many households like that. Kids are missing that. Everybody like, this is my child. You can't say that to my child. You can't correct my child.
Right.
That whole village is gone.
Right.
And our kids is fucked up. And society is becoming even more fucked up because of that.
Absolutely.
You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So for me, I want to be on the 501c3 side so that I can have that place that kids can come to. So that I can give that guidance to kids on a larger scale. So that kids can have somewhere safe to go because mama at work, daddy ain't there. Instead of just being out in the street. You see what I'm saying? When you walk down Glenwood, come on down to the, you know, Derwin and Phyllis Brown Foundation. Come sit in the homework lab and use the computer. Do your homework. Let's work on your project. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? You need to talk to a social worker. Come talk to a social worker. Mm-hmm. You see, you just want to have somewhere to kick it and you just want to play video games, play video games. But have somewhere safe to do it at. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I just feel like the kids are the future. Adults already fucked. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's easier to mold and shape a child than it is an adult. And the children are the future. Who you think gonna be the future doctors, the lawyers, the people that have to run our society? Mm-hmm. How do you change the politicians? You gotta start them here and grow these as politicians.
That's right.
Believe in the people and then let them get up there. You can't go to no grown man that already had an idea of what he trying to get in once he get in office. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You start with the kids. Mm-hmm. And to me, I feel like I can have a bigger impact on that side. But when I tell you, I get posed that very often.
Yeah.
People are like, when you going to run for office? I'm telling you, I got people that are bad.
It's not about what you want to do, it's what you called to do.
That's true. That's true.
Do and you I feel that calling?
I do. So it's funny because I just sold my house, you know, in Tucker. Mm-hmm. And I moved back to the east side. I moved back to Decatur. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? To South DeKalb, because that's where my heart is. Mm-hmm. Now, one thing about me, I don't shy away from what my calling is. Mm-hmm. But I do believe that God is going to lead you. I'm very open to wherever he takes me to. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? I meditate. I fast. When I feel like something in my spirit and I can't pinpoint it, mm-hmm. I'm going to sit and I'm going to listen to him. So if he leads me there, I'm not against it. Yeah. But I know that he understands my heart. Mm-hmm. And he understands, you know, what I really want to do. So it's like I don't feel like he'll ever put me in that position if he feel like it's I can't make the impact that I want to make to really help the people.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. PTSD. First of all, when we talk about, you know, our governmental systems and stuff like that, it goes back to conversations that I was having with somebody earlier. You know, we were taught to believe in Santa Claus, okay? This is the way that the government is supposed to be working. They're supposed to be for the people and by the people. When you see corrupt things going on and people becoming, you know, assassinated just by trying to move the culture forward, and you realize that this might not be all that it's cracked up to be, and it's definitely not what they portray it to be, mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on that, just in politics and then the world in general? Reality versus fiction.
Correct. And that's the thing. I don't even look at TV. So I look at movies, but I don't look at TV. So you can't ask me nothing about no rappers, no socialites, mm-hmm. you know, housewives. On God, I don't know nobody.
Yeah.
And that is because I learned from having to be in the media mm-hmm. how much the media controls what we think and how we feel.
Come on now.
And what they show you what they want to show you.
Thank you.
And so the whole time we're sitting there and we thinking we getting the news. You getting the story. No, you're getting their version of the story. Right. It's a lot of meat and potatoes that's been left out.
Right.
So you can't even make an intelligent decision on your theory of what's really happening
Thank you.
They're giving you to invoke. They want to invoke fear. They want to invoke all of these emotions that we get. You see what I'm saying? It's mm-hmm. done on purpose. Mm-hmm. So I think if people, because that's the problem, a lot of people don't, I don't realize until I start having conversations, a lot of people don't know that. A lot of people really think that what the government tells them is facts.
Oh, absolutely.
Or the television.
Yes. Right.
Or the Instagram.
Yes.
And they will argue your ass down about why you wrong.
Right. And you know what, B? I'm glad you brought that up because when you say like Instagram and all that kind of stuff influence your stuff. Like, B-Hi thought that the BG was getting out of the jail because he saw an Instagram post. And something in me knew that that wasn't the BG. But because he was in...
guy, looked just like the BG. Yeah, but because as a news contributor, I said, my people need this damn story now.
You were influenced by the media.
That's what happened. And at least I retracted that story.
Had everybody
too.
Standing outside the damn prison. Everybody. Waiting on him to walk out with
that sign. It did 50,000 views in 5 minutes. A week. Man, don't promise me a raise and everything off this one. But hey, call me back, Rick. You know, I gotta.
Hey, he done started calling, trying to see what a party gonna be in there.
Yes.
What's the move?
Yes. And that's the whole thing right there, though, too, because when I think about the reality of the story that you just gave us, it wore me out. I mean, I almost had to wipe this man's eye. It's almost every week I have to wipe a tear from his damn eye because he's looking for an excuse to cry.
First of all, I can cry if I want to. I'm a man. I'm confident in who I am.
Come on.
One good cry a year for me is it helps with the soul. Mm-hmm. After getting me one
it
good cry out.
It cleanses.
Now, you better be worried if I cry to whoop your ass. Those are two different type of cries.
No, I don't want you to give me a battle cry. Right. Keep the battle cry to yourself.
What would Galaxy Week do?
Exactly. Thank you. Thank you. You are so turning back the OG Gangsta Week.
What would Galaxy Week do?
So, Brandy... how can people that have been through similar things, you know, that need to talk to you, need to reach out to you, how can they reach you and start networking with people like you?
Mm-hmm. Wait a minute. Before we get to that one, though, too, I need to ask you this, though, Brandy. The devastation of dreams being crushed and deferred. Mm. How did that impact the family,
you know,
having to witness that?
How powerful that is?
Yeah.
Let me tell you this. So when I was filming one of the people for my podcast, I didn't finish saying the podcast is about getting people to know who he was and his impact on not just us, but other people.
Okay.
How did it impact everyday people that he dealt with?
Okay.
So on one of the shows, I'm just making sure there was a higher up, higher ranking person, right, that was really good friends with my dad. Mm-hmm. And he took his office during the same time when my dad was elected. Mm-hmm. And I can remember going to him, and he was a go-to for me. I would go in his office. I would cry. I would cuss. I would tell him I'm ready to fuck somebody up. He gonna hear it. You know what I mean? He gonna hug me, and he gonna be like, it's gonna be okay. You know what I mean?
Right.
But one thing I noticed that during that time, he would often say to me, he said, I'm not made for this position.
Mm.
Now, wasn't because he couldn't do it, you know, and what he would say is, I'm a police officer, I'm not a politician. Mm. That's specifically what he would say, which let me know he was feeling the political pressures of being in the position that he was, and it should have been an officer position, right? But it was the politics behind it. And one thing, when I interviewed him, he told me, he said, once your father was killed, he said, I lost my hope and my vision for being in that position. Wow. He said, when we talked about, me and your father talked about him being the sheriff and me being in my position, we created a vision together for DeKalb County. Exactly. And for these offices. You see what I'm saying? And once my father was killed, that dream was gone. He had no vision. You know how powerful that is for another man to say that? When he told me that, I was like, wow.
Yeah.
But that's the purpose of the podcast, is so people can understand this impact. Yes, it impacted us.
Mm-hmm.
But it also impacted other people just as hard, just as bad. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But it took his dream away. Mm-hmm. And so there are so many other people out there like that he was bringing over, whether they was coming to the sheriff's department with him or he had made plans for this county. with them.
Come on.
You see what I mean? Because one thing about my daddy, he was powerful.
Yes.
Yeah.
I tell people all the time, a lot of people didn't like my daddy, but you damn sure was going to respect
you
him.
You sure? Now, I know that. I used to be out there flirting with Brandy all the time. During Brown pull up, he give you one little look like this. Brandy get in line, she going that way right now. We going this way. The block was a ghost town when it got. But he was, from what I just know, from what I just seen, he was like just what she said. He was a man that when you saw it, you knew you had to be in line. You know you had to be on your best behavior. He expected greatness.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He would come in the hood for this one.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Come and get her from over here from, we over there with guns. She would say, man, if anybody tell you that I wasn't out there, if anybody, this one knows. She knows. Matter of fact, I don't want her to become sheriff because she might have my statute of limitation warrant on stuff. So Brandy knows, but her father, yeah. I'm not going to come get me in certain spots. She'd be like, well, when you get here, this is what it is. Doing Brown.
He pulled right up.
Oh, he pulled up. Oh, yeah. Yeah, he pulled right up about this one.
Yeah, he literally had no fear. Mm-hmm. But he also had a standard. Let me tell you something. After my father was killed, you want to tell you the most surprising thing that happened for me? Mm-hmm. I had guys writing from prison that he had locked up.
Damn.
Wow.
And they were, you know, expressing their sympathy, but talked about how much respect they had for him. Because they said even though he locked them up, he respected them.
Come on.
He treated them as people.
Exactly.
He was still talking to them about why they shouldn't have been doing what they was doing and how they can do better and what they should expect from themselves. That was powerful.
That's deep.
Exactly.
That was powerful. And he done locked up some big time ones in DeKalb County.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? Right. But he always respected you no matter what.
Yeah.
Now you got officers want to talk down to you like you not a man and treat you like you an animal because they got this uniform. Mm-hmm. They punks.
And what would you say to though? And I'm glad you brought it up to those type of officers. I've been locked up, you know, thank God I ain't been to prison or nothing, but I have been locked up in pretty much every county in Georgia.
America.
But my thing is though, be how she's right, because and I really got it bad from Atlanta. Remember I told you that, you know, because Atlanta would have it to where if you locked up on Rice Street, they would still have to chain you up, put you on a bus, and take you over to the courthouse.
Mm-hmm.
And so they would take us downstairs and put us in these big old cages and stuff. And the officers would talk to you. So I'm talking about, bitch, oh, cracker, nigga. Just like you would rather them beat you.
Damn.
Then how they will emasculate you.
Yeah.
And I started to notice that it was a thing with a lot of counties with the COs inside the jails and stuff to emasculate, to try to break you mentally. It wasn't even about the physical as much. Yeah. Just to break you mentally. Have you seen that type of stuff with officers and COs and stuff?
I mean, I guess more so, right, things that's happened in the media and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's funny. One night, I did get pulled over. I was in Gwinnett. And, the officer, from the time he walked up to the window, you know, I'm like, good evening, whatever. He just, like, rude. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
I'm like, and the funny, messed up part about it, I didn't know my license had expired.
Mm. Right, right.
My birthday had just passed. I had no clue my license had expired.
Yeah.
And so when he told me, I was like, what? Like, I was dead surprised. You know what I mean? And I was like, oh, my God. And he had it. I said, well, when did it expire? You know, and he was like, well, you ought to know. And did it. I mean, and I'm looking, right? So I'm like, I got my kids in the car.
Right.
Because I'm like, oh, this nigga trying me.
Yeah.
That's that hood side.
Right.
So I was like, okay, so I ain't say nothing. So he goes on back. He come back. I don't know what he read when he went back there, but when he came back, he was talking a whole nother tune. Like his respect.
He knew who you are.
So my daughter, I was like, y'all see that? They looking. They was like, I mean, it was like a Jekyll and Hyde type shit. Right. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
But it's just like it wasn't even necessary from the jump.
Come on.
It wasn't necessary.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Right. But I'm seriously, you got the ones that was bullied in school or ego, or they got this uniform now. They feel like it gives them this power. But see, police officers are supposed to protect and serve. They done lost that. They done forgot that. I don't even know if they teach that shit no more. Yeah. Right?
Right.
They're supposed to protect us and serve. They are servers to us. We the people. We pay them.
Correct.
They work for us. But they don't even, it's like that's not in there anymore. It's like that part skipped over. So it's like automatically you're a criminal. It's a crime.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so going back to what we were talking about the how the media controls and try to control what you think, right? Mm-hmm. Let's just break this whole shit down. These laws somebody fucking made up. Exactly. This shit ain't even real. Like this is not even it's not even real.
Right.
How somebody woke up one morning.
Right.
Yeah. Right?
Jaywalking.
So how is it that serious to make you feel like you have to enforce this power? Like, it's just a matter of respect. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
My license expired. Okay, I apologize. If you need to give me a ticket for it, cool. I'm going to go handle it.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? It's not a crime. I ain't killed no damn body because my license expired.
Right.
It still tell you who the fuck I am. Yeah, I'm still the same person.
Right. Yeah. Right.
You get what I'm saying? So it's just like they just take stuff to a whole nother level for no reason. Yeah. But here's the thing. You're dealing with humans.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't care who, what human, every human has trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Every human has trauma.
Wow.
So when you're dealing with humans, you have to remember you're dealing with their traumas, their issues, and how many people really do the work? How many people do shadow work on themselves? How many people wake up every day and look themselves in the mirror and say, damn, I got a bad attitude for no reason. Why do I have that bad attitude?
Right.
Why do I have to be snappy?
Right.
Right?
Right.
People don't even do the work on themselves because I don't want to acknowledge that something is wrong with me.
Right.
But if you say...
It got to be you.
Yeah, it's always somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I did that because that person did that. No, sir. You are the only person that have control over you. I don't care what nobody does to
Absolutely.
You. You can slap the shit out of me. It's a choice on whether I want to fuck you up.
Right.
Or if I'm going to be like, you know what? All right, you got that. Because really, when you slap shit out of me, that tells me something wrong with you. Mm. You need to do the work on you.
Now, could I pay you to slap a certain person? That I mean, I'm not going to say his name, but it rhymes with C-Sky. but Brandy, let me, on this note, too, before I, this will be my last question to you right here. Talk to us about, we have, you know, talked about, you know, the system and certain cops and stuff and, you know, SEALs that are wrong. Talk about the good ones. Talk about some of the ones that helped y'all, your family through this, that were there for y'all.
Absolutely.
That pull you over and not, you know, try to emasculate you, you know, make you feel bad because your license expired. Talk to us about some of the good ones because when we're all in trouble, we're going to push that 911. And I tell people that all the time. We can always say, fuck the police. It's the easiest thing to say. But when somebody got your family, your daughter, your son, you know, breaking in your house, the first thing you're going to do is grab that tool and call the police. So talk to us about, you know, some of the good cops that.
Absolutely. So, I mean, I think just like anything in any job in the world, you always got good people that are in it for the right reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so you do have some people that go into law enforcement that genuinely want to help people. That's why they join.
Right.
Right. They want to be that person that if something happens to your grandmother, I want to be the person to be there to help her, you know, soothe her. Like you're dealing, really it's customer service, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so you want people that are good with people.
Mm-hmm.
You want people, and there are plenty of them out there.
Mm-hmm.
I do think they were more so prevalent back in the day than they are now just because of the day of the time. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are joining because they want that check. They see that it pays okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So, and they also see it as a stepping stone. A lot of people want to get to the FBI.
Mm-hmm.
And they use police to get to the FBI.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But there are people that genuinely want to help people. And there are officers that do that. And it's funny because not too long ago, I was surprised. I saw a police officer on the side of the road helping someone change a tire.
Right.
Do you know how few and far between that is?
Right.
Do you remember back in the day, police officers used to carry jimmies in their car and paint the tools?
Uh-huh.
And they would help you if you were locked out your car.
Yeah.
They would help you change a tire.
Yeah.
They stopped that.
Yeah.
You know, and I understand in somewhat why, because some people were suing the county, because if you do it and you break my door, I want to sue you because now I want you to pay for it. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
I get it, you know, but I think it takes the humanity out of the work that they're doing.
Yeah.
And you have to be humble. You have to treat people like people. And I just don't get it. I personally think, I don't know if you ever heard of the DISC. There's a personality test called DISC.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of corporations use this to see if you're a good fit for their organization. Mm-hmm. It tells whether you are, you know, a more people person or whether you're very analytic.
Mm-hmm.
It tells you all about this and what are good fields that you should be in.
Mm-hmm.
I personally think teaching, mm-hmm. police officers, even nurses and doctors, I think they should be required to take that.
That's right.
Because if you don't have in your personality to where you are a people person,
you don't need to be dealing with people.
You do not need to be dealing with people.
Right.
You don't.
Right.
If you don't like people, I don't want you policing my community.
Exactly.
Right. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't even make sense.
Yeah.
Right. So the days of going and where you see, you know, you used to have a little drunk at the gas station.
Yeah.
Most time, he stays somewhere close by.
Right.
His people somewhere around.
Right. Yeah.
Back in the day, they'd just call your people or just take you to the house.
Yeah.
Now they want to harass you and lock you up. Man, mm-hmm. take that man home.
Exactly.
It don't even it doesn't cause for all of that.
Right.
Right? But the humanity is gone in the people they're serving and protecting, and so automatically, he's a criminal. That's probably your damn daddy.
Right.
Come on.
Oh, it was your granddaddy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Again, that's your trauma, your triggers. See what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. People don't even realize your trigger is a reason that you react in a certain way with certain people.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're having a trigger moment.
Yeah.
From some shit from your past that you ain't dealt with.
Which you ain't dealt with.
That's why the world is the way it is. People have so much baggage and they don't deal with it. Mm-hmm. And what you do, you're going to put your shit off on somebody else.
Absolutely.
I always say I got a post-traumatic stress to poverty.
Very well said.
Shit, this shit stresses me out when I think about it. It do.
Hey, he do, because that's like every week, every time. It's the poverty that goes.
But this is my other question. Getting back up. At what point were you able to get back up? Because obviously you had to be the rock for the family. For two generations prior and your future generations, at what point did you find normalcy and get back to yourself?
So after 2012, my brother dropped dead, just really weird, but it's still weird to me to this day because my brother, anybody that knows him, he was a health nut. Like he worked out every day. He walked around with a gallon jug of water. Like he would get on me about buying genetically modified fruits. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like that's how health conscious he was. He didn't eat pork. He didn't eat beef. He didn't drink.
Yeah.
Like if I made him take a sip, he gonna be drunk because he don't have no tolerance because he don't drink. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, he was driving to go pick up his kids and end up having a heart attack in the car.
Damn.
So 30 days later is when my grandmother, when I was changing her, and she, you know, ended up having a heart attack and dying.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, it was just the kids, right? So about 2014, that's when my last baby started school.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I had been at home all these years, right, because I had been a caretaker, so I was at home for my other girls. I was an at-home mom.
Mm-hmm.
And so when she started school, I was like, okay. I need to start figuring out who Brandy is.
Yeah.
What is it that Brandy like? What's your favorite color? What's really your favorite food? What do you like to do? You know what I mean? I started trying to dig deep into figuring out who I was. I've gone through a lot of classes. Like, I've done the work. You know what I mean? I went through a couple of trainings with Dr. Sylvia High. She has an organization called Aiming High. And it just helps you dig deep to help you remember who you are and accept you for who you are. You know what I mean? And then do the work on the things that you don't like. Right? But face who you really are. A lot of us don't do that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We just brush it off like, oh, it's like it's not a big deal. Oh, it's a big deal. Because how you are and who you are affects the person that you laying next with every day. That's or right. Even your best friends, how you interact, your relationships, mm-hmm. all of that matters. You know, so I started doing the work. And I kept doing the work. And then I started reading more. And I started listening to podcasts. Like, I'm a self-help guru. You know, like, I'm always in it, trying to learn more how to be a better version of me. And just the one thing is just remembering who you are. I had to remember who I was. I had forgotten. Going through all of that and with how the county treated us and the disrespect that I felt like we had, It made me lose my confidence for a little while. My confidence was attached, and I realized later, to who my parents were, right? And I think that's for most kids.
Yeah.
Originally, that's your first initial kind of who you are. It's attached to your parents, right? And then you start getting that individuality. But for me, it was attached to that. So going through that, like, it kind of broke my confidence. It kind of broke... That light. But going through the classes, going through the training, doing the reading, doing the work, I am light. And okay. I was able to remember that. So I had to really remember who I am and remember, I'm like, yeah, them, you know, these people can't break me. They can't break what was already instilled and what my parents created, you know. And so then I think in 2014, 2015, I got a job. Like, I was at home. You know what I mean? I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. I went to college for computer programming, but I'm not an introvert, so I don't want to be behind nobody's computer all day. You know what I mean? So that wasn't going to be the move.
Yeah.
And so then that's when I started getting into real estate and growing in that field. You know what I mean? But still... the community is my passion. It was a dilemma for a little while on that because for a long time I asked, was it worth it? My parents gave and gave and gave to the community.
They gave their lives.
Literally.
For the community.
Was it worth it? Right? So then I had to question myself because it's just natural. It's who I am. To the core of who I am, I can't, even if I try not to help a person, I can't help it. It's just who I am. And so it was an inner battle because I'm like, do I give, do I do? And then is it worth it? Are they gonna really appreciate it? What happens when I'm gone?
Right.
Who gonna look out for my kids?
Right.
Right? So that inner battle, excuse me, that inner battle was there. But ultimately, you know, I had to find myself and I do, I still care about my people. And I can't help but to, because the kids are leading the world.
Yeah.
I don't know why these other folks don't care, but they better care.
Yeah, there's gonna be the people.
Because that's gonna be the people that's taking care of your ass in a nursing home.
Right, yeah.
That's
right.
Gonna be the people that's making decisions if you on the damn operating table.
Absolutely, yeah, right.
Like, these kids
are
the future. They're the ones that's gonna be making policy.
Right.
If we want something different to happen in Washington, or really most importantly, our local government, then you have to pour into these kids so that they can grow up to make the difference. Who else you think gonna do it?
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Right.
And because I care about my life, I care about my kids' life, I care about the quality of life, I can't help but care about the people.
And on that note, the contact again.
Brandy, tell the people that need to reach out to you, and the people just, you know, want to be nosy, because you know we got a lot of people that don't want them, but just to see what you're doing.
Yeah,
you know. Tell
them
how to get contact.
Well, let me tell you what I'm doing.
You.
So I do have the podcast, The Naked Truth. We have not decided on a release date yet, but we're still working on that. So that is coming.
Okay.
Eventually, I'll get the book out, y'all. It's so hard for me to write this book. The first book is not without my father. So
make sure you talk to before you publish that book. Talk to Man Behind. Yeah. You know, we got a little something. You know,
I need a good ghostwriter. I have a good friend that does stuff like that, and I keep telling her she need to go on and write it for me, because The problem is, now, one thing, and we didn't say the trauma, the PTSD, right? One thing that has happened for me is that it made me, in order to function and survive, I had to compartmentalize, okay? So you have to remember, I'm 22, I'm having to do interviews, I'm doing, so in my mind, I can't be up there crying and breaking down and emotional. You got to hold it together, right? Yeah. So in order to do that, I had to compartmentalize, and I almost separated myself from the situation. Yeah. So at one point, I started writing a book, and when I had the editor look at it, she was like, this is like a paper. She said, and it's as if you're writing about somebody else's life. She said, it's no memories in it. There's no emotion in it. There's none of that in it, you know? And I literally sat and I kept trying to write it. My mind will not allow me to write it. It's crazy. I can talk. If you ask the right questions, you can get the emotion out of me. But the part of your brain, and I learned this going through therapy with my mom, is definitely different parts of the brain that controls writing and that controls speech. People don't realize that. It's separate. So when I'm talking, if you ask the right questions, you'll get the emotion. But when I'm writing, it's a whole block. My mind won't even let me, I can't even remember. It's memories that I totally cannot remember. So anyway, the book, I really want to do the book, but I'm trying to find me a really good ghostwriter that can help me get it out and get the emotion in there and all that good stuff. Also, I'm a loan officer, so I do mortgages. I do my part in helping people, right? By helping people achieve the American dream. I deal with a lot of people that don't even think they could ever have owned a home. You would be surprised. I bought my first house when I was 21. I'm dealing with people that's in their 50s that's never owned a home and feel like they may not be able to. So to help people do that and accomplish that, that is so rewarding for me. Like, seriously,
that is.
It's really rewarding for me. So I'm a loan officer. I've been doing that for the last nine years. So I enjoy that. And then outside of that, you know, I do have my life coaching certification. I tell people all the time, I'm always life coaching my clients when I'm getting them into a house. When you're, you know, and real estate agents can relate too. It's like you're a therapist, you're the best friend, and you're the loan officer. That's what I'm saying? So I said one day I'll probably actually start the life coaching business and do that on the side or something. But mainly I do my mortgages, and I'm working on this podcast that I'm excited about. And then I also sit on the board of nonprofit organizations, so Community Action Now. We are based in Metro, and we do a lot of work in the Metro area and also in the U.S. Virgin Islands. And we, let me put this plug in, we actually just got contracted. So, you know, Google is starting to do certifications. We are one of only five organizations in the state of Georgia that has been able to partner with Google on getting those certifications. So we'll be able to have people come through us to get certifications. You can make good money. Have you seen the money they're paying with them Google certifications?
Exactly.
And you know how many of our kids are not meant for college? They don't want to go to college.
I mean, I'd rather them get a Google certification and give me some water on the corner, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, get a Google certification because you can come out making $60,000, $70,000, $80,000.
That water be good, though.
It don't be cold.
That's because you've been jacking the water boys and taking all that damn water, Wick. Something just never changed.
He probably the one that taught them how to do that Cash App trip they was talking about. Having people on Cash App, and it's supposed to have been like $20 and they taking $200. Yeah. You probably showed them how to do that.
I might have. I plead the fifth.
Brandy, thank you so much for your time today.
You can find me at The Brandy Brown on Instagram and The Brandy Brown on Facebook.
All right. Beehive Radio Shouty, OG Intergalactical Wicked, Brandy Brown. Holler at y'all in a minute, man. We gone.